It's one of the most recognizable and most loved smells, the aroma of fresh ground coffee. Today, a deep dive into coffee grinders, details on how they work, their parts, features, and terminology. It's a short course in coffee grinders, everything you need to know to choose the grinder that's right for you. Hey, coffee lovers, Mark here from Whole Latte Love. So picking a grinder, yeah, it's tough. There's so many to choose from. Now, we stock grinders from a couple dozen manufacturers, about 100 different models in all. It's a huge range from entry-level brew grinders up to precision instruments appropriate for specialty coffee roasters and geek-level home espresso enthusiasts. So by the end of this video, you're gonna know what you need to know. But if you still want some one-on-one advice, our staff of coffee pros is here to help you out. You can give them a call or use live chat or email, and you can use the link up here to get our contact info to do that. Or use those comments down there, and I'd be happy to give you some advice myself. We know and use these products every day, and we work closely with manufacturers. We visit their facilities and participate in new product design and evaluation like we're doing now with Giotto and their E37Z Hero Grinder. Now, in this video, I'll only cover burr grinders. There are cheaper blade grinders available, but my first piece of advice is to stay far, far away from those. You know, one key goal of coffee grinding, regardless of brew method, is producing a grind with a consistent particle size. Blade grinders, well, they're terrible in that respect. They hack coffee beans into random-sized particles, ranging from dust to chunks. Coffee made from that stuff, yeah, it's gonna produce yucky, mucky cups that are unbalanced, under and over-extracted, so sour and bitter at the same time. Honestly, you're better off using pre-ground coffee than chopping up coffee with a blade grinder, so you definitely want a burr grinder. When choosing a grinder, the first big question is, what's your brew method? Do you need a brew grinder, an espresso specialist, or a multi-purpose grinder? Now, if you are not particular, a multi-purpose grinder can serve for all brew methods, but if you're even slightly serious about espresso, you'll really want an espresso specialist. On the other hand, most espresso specialist grinders can go coarse enough for brew grinding, but you'll get better results with a dedicated brew grinder. Espresso grinders usually produce more fine particles at medium grind sizes, which can cause bitter cups when used for other brew methods. Now, I'm not going to focus too much on particular grinders here. This video is about how they work, their parts, features, and terminology. If you want recommendations, use a link up here to watch a video on our picks for the best grinders in 5 different categories, plus a bunch of honorable mentions. So first, let's talk build quality. Now, I like to group them into appliance level and machine level. Appliance level build quality is going to have a lot of plastic used in construction. They'll be subject to damage if abused through mishandling or heavy use. At some point, you will likely be replacing an appliance level grinder. On the other hand, grinders at the machine level use robust construction with mostly metal components inside and out. They are built to last with an expectation of decades of reliable surface and almost always produce a better grind with better particle size control. Now, that said, there are some grinders which straddle the appliance versus machine classification. The Baratza Vario is a really good example of that, with some metal, some plastic, decent build, and outstanding manufacturer support. In fact, the Vario changed the game for home espresso grinding about a decade ago and is one of my favorite multi-purpose grinders. Now, unless you're going with a hand crank manual grinder, it's gonna have a motor, and those motors are rated in watts and range from about 100 to more than 400 watts. Now, more powerful motors give longer duty cycles. That is, they can grind more coffee and they usually do it faster. Appliance level grinders with lower power motors often have duty cycles around 10%, meaning grind for 60 seconds and the grinder should rest for about 10 minutes before using it again. Now, grinding is done by burrs and they come in sets. Inside the grinder, one burr spins and the other is held in place. To change the grind size, the spacing between the burrs is adjusted. Now, there are different methods of adjusting that space, and I'll have more on that in a minute. Burr sizes are measured in millimeters, ranging from about 40 to 83 or more, in high-end commercial espresso grinders. Now, in general, bigger burrs produce a better grind and in most cases grind faster. There are two basic types of burrs, conical and flat. Conical burrs are more common in lower cost brew grinders, but you'll also find them in a few home use and high-end, high-speed commercial espresso grinders. Flat burrs are most common in espresso grinders. Is one shape better than the other? Well, it's debatable. Personally, I prefer conical burrs for brew grinding as they tend to produce fewer fines. For espresso, flats are more common, but I've never had issue with espresso ground with conical burrs. Burrs are usually made of steel, but you will find ceramic burrs and even titanium-coated burrs. Ceramic burrs stay sharp longer, but are brittle, so more susceptible to damage by foreign objects. Now, I've ground a lot of coffee through ceramics and never had a problem. In any case, the steel burrs in most grinders are good for more than 1,000 pounds of coffee. Now, ECM says the titanium-coated burrs and its V-Titan grinder are good for well over 2,000 pounds of grinding, and for the average home user, that's about 100 years of grinding. Grind size is changed by adjusting the spacing between the burrs. Grinders can have stepped adjustment with definite stops at each grind size, or stepless adjustment with no stops, so grind size is continuously variable. Stepped adjustment is more common on brew grinders, and having stepped adjustment makes it very easy to change the grind size and then go back to a grind size you've used before. Stepless adjustment is more common on espresso grinders, where tiny size changes can make a really big difference. Now, you will find some espresso grinders with stepped grind size adjustment. On those, the steps are either very small and concentrated in the espresso range, or they may use something like you'll find on the Baratza Sette 270 grinders with micro adjustments within each of the macro size steps. At the end of the day, that macro micro setup gives you the fine control needed for espresso. Now, moving the burr position is done in a number of different ways. There are levers like on the Baratza Vario, turning collars, which are very common on espresso grinders, turning hoppers on some Baratza grinders, as well as a Ranchillo Rocky and Gaja MDF, and knob adjustment like on most grinders made by Eureka. The turning hoppers and levers are usually stepped adjustments and all the control you'll need for a brew grinder. For espresso grinders with stepless adjustment, the collars are turned by hand, but you'll also find some with worm gears doing the turning. The amount of grinds delivered can be controlled manually with simple on-off function. That's common on brew grinders and many espresso grinders. Beyond that are timing functions. So each time you start the grinder, it grinds for a programmed amount of time. At the upper end are grinders with programmable weight-based dosing. You program the weight desired and the grinder weighs the coffee as it's ground and stops automatically when the desired weight is reached. On time and weight-based grinders, you usually have the ability to program more than one preset. Those presets, they can be a big help, especially in espresso brewing where consistency is key. The next consideration is where the grinds go after grinding. With brew grinders, there's a collection bin of some kind. Espresso grinders are usually set up to grind directly into a portafilter. On multi-purpose grinders, you may be able to grind into a bin and a portafilter. Many espresso grinders have a portafilter activated switch, which can start and stop grinding, and some have a way of holding the portafilter in place for hands-free grinding. Ground coffee is delivered by a chute, or some have a dosing funnel. On those, coffee grinds into the funnel where it's broken up and directed into the portafilter. A grinder with a doser is a less popular option for home use. On dosing grinders, coffee is ground into a chamber and held there until a lever is pulled to deliver ground coffee in measured doses. Now, a couple of special notes on espresso grinders and things to look for. First, pay attention to how the grinds fall into the portafilter. Centered and even distribution is what you want. And how do the grinds look? A good espresso grinder produces fluffy, relatively clump-free grinds. Also, consider how easy it is to get into the grinding chamber for cleaning and then putting things back together. With some, it's just a few screws and you're in and you can put things back together quickly and without loss of your grind setting or calibration. On others, it's a little trickier in that you lose your grind setting and there may be some extensive cleaning required of the fine internal adjustment threads before reassembly if the grinding chamber is not isolated from the threads. Now, one last thing to consider is grind retention. That is how much ground coffee remains in the grinder after grinding. Usually not a big concern for brew grinding, as the ratio of retention to coffee used is relatively high. But for some espresso heads, it is a big deal, as the ratios are a lot lower and they want a coffee dose that is as fresh as possible. That's when we start talking about near zero retention grinders. If you're interested in learning about those, use a link up here to watch my video testing the grind retention results of a number of popular espresso grinders. So to recap, things to think about when selecting a grinder. Do you want a brew grinder, an espresso grinder, or do you want to go multi-purpose? What kind of build quality and motor power? Are you okay with a lower powered appliance grade, or would you like something more robust, a machine grade grinder that could run for decades? What kind of burrs will work best for your needs? For brew grinding, those conical is common, and for espresso, it's flat with bigger, usually better, but there are excellent espresso grinders using conical burrs as well. How much control of grind size do you need, and how do you want to adjust it? Will stepped grind size work for you, or do you need more control with micro or stepless size adjustment? How do you want to control dosing? There's totally manual, time-based, and weight-based, and how do you want the grounds delivered? A bin is all you need for brew grinding, or you can go all the way to hands-free, portafilter activated grinding with multiple presets for espresso. So there's a lot to consider and a lot of grinders to choose from, but hopefully you've got some background now to help you out. If you need advice picking the right grinder, again, you can always talk one-on-one with one of our coffee pros, or use those comments and I'd be happy to help you out. I'm Mark, thanks for watching, and I hope you'll come on back soon for more of the best on everything coffee, brought to you by Whole Latte Love. Want to learn more? Subscribe now so you'll know about the latest videos on everything coffee from Whole Latte Love.